There we go. Also, we know mathematically, we have great mathematicians like David Hilbert. He said the infinite is nowhere to be found in reality. So we know that the universe is not eternal, that it began to exist. Now, the problem for atheists, like physicist PCW Davy says, he says the coming into being of the universe as discussed in modern science is not just a matter of imposing some sort of organization upon a previous incoherent state. But listen, guys, literally the coming into being of all physical things from nothing. Now, this puts the atheist in a very awkward position. You guys have heard of Anthony Kinney of Oxford. He says if someone's an atheist, they must believe that the universe came from nothing and by nothing. So the cosmological argument is a very difficult problem for atheists, because we know out of nothing, nothing comes. So why does the universe exist instead of just nothing? There must have been a cause which brought the universe into being. Now, as the cause of space and time, logically, this being must be uncaused, timeless, spaceless, immaterial, and it must have unfathomable power. It must be personal as well, because the cause must be beyond space and time. It cannot be physical or material. There was no pre-existing singularity, matter, or energy. Now, when you think about it, there are only two kinds of things that fit this description, either an abstract object, like numbers, for example, or else a personal mind. Now, we got about 20 of you in the room. I want all of you guys to think of a big elephant, a big, giant elephant. Now, if you were to die and they were to have an autopsy on your brain, they wouldn't find that elephant. Where is that elephant? Because your mind created it, you see. The problem, though, is abstract object like numbers can't create anything. So it follows that the cause of the universe is a transcendent, intelligent mind. That's the cosmological argument. It gives us a personal creator of the universe. Now, let's go to the teleological argument. In recent decades, scientists have been shocked to discover that the initial conditions of the universe were fine-tuned for the existence of life. Now, sometimes atheists will say, well, it's not that it's fine-tuned, it's just that we evolved into it, but they can't use that escape, because even the Earth would not exist without the fine-tuning, even the rate of expansion of the universe. There would be no life. Now, if you go to shockandowe.net and you click links, I have a list of the constants there and the quantities. There's about 50 of them. And guys, I can't stress enough how fine-tuned these constants are. We're literally living on a razor's edge. Let me give you an example. The atomic weak force. If it were altered by as little as one part out of 10 to the 100th power, it wouldn't even permit a life-permitting universe. So when an atheist says, well, we evolved into the fine-tuning, they can't use that argument, because we wouldn't even have the Earth there. For example, even stars, we wouldn't even have the stars there, and which are necessary for us to have life here, for planets to exist. I'm not going to go through all 50 of them, but if you guys question me on it or if I'm asked that, I'll go through the list of, there's about 50 of these fine-tuned constants. What's amazing, some of their ratios even to each other have to be fine-tuned. Now, there's only three possible explanations of this remarkable fine-tuning: physical necessity, like something in natural law, dumb luck and chance, or design. Well, we know it's not due to physical necessity. There's nothing in the constants and quantities that show this. In fact, they're independent of the laws of nature. So we have to rule physical necessity and dumb luck and chance out. It can't be due to dumb luck and chance, because the problem with that alternative is that the odds against the fine-tuning is occurring by accident are so incomprehensibly great they cannot be reasonably faced. In fact, an atheist would have to convince us to believe not one, not two, not five, not 10, not 20, not 30, not 40, but about 50 of these constants, just by dumb luck and chance, all just happen to land on this razor-thin edge. See, the problem probability that all constants and quantities would fall by chance alone into this life-permitting range is vanishingly small, and we all know that life-prohibiting universes are vastly more probable than any life-permitting universe. Why isn't life scattered by dumb luck and chance throughout the universe? It's clearly focused right here. So if the universe were the product of chance, the odds are overwhelming that it would be life-prohibiting. Now, there's three different reasons for this. We know it's not due to dumb luck or chance. We know there's nothing in physical necessity that would cause it to be that way. It therefore follows logically that the best explanation is design. Now, if you're bigoted or prejudiced towards God, then you're not going to like that. And I, as an ex-atheist, I want to be man enough to go where the evidence leads me without bias or bigotry. And the evidence clearly reeks of intelligent design. It leads right to intelligent design. Since the fine-tuning is not due to dumb luck or chance or physical necessity, it follows rationally and logically that the best explanation is design. Let's go to the moral argument. If God does not exist, objective moral values do not exist. And you guys know by objective values, we mean moral values which are valid and binding whether we believe in them or not. For example, to say what Hitler did was wrong is to say that it would still be wrong even if you were Hitler himself. The actions that he did, the evil that he did was wrong even if you were Hitler and you thought it wasn't wrong or it was justified. Now, many atheists and theists agree that if God does not exist, moral values are not objective in this way. The problem, though, is I don't see any reason to think that in the absence of God, the morality which atheists tell us has just evolved by evolution is objective. See, on the atheistic view, an action like rape, the atheist will say, well, it's not socially advantageous, and so through human development, it's become taboo. But it does absolutely nothing to prove that rape is really morally wrong. The evil of atheism is, on the atheistic view, there's nothing really wrong with raping someone. Look up atheism and bestiality when you have a chance, and you'll see that that's a major problem right now if you do a Google search on that in atheism. The problem, though, in the real world is that objective values do exist, and deep down we all know it. We have moral experience, and we apprehend a realm of objective morals, goods, and evils. Actions like rape, cruelty, and child abuse aren't just socially unacceptable behavior. They're really evil. Some things, at least, are really wrong. So we have objective moral values, and it follows logically that if objective moral values exist, then God exists. If you agree, and we all do, that there is a difference between good and evil, love and hate, then we must agree, and it follows necessarily that God exists. Number four, the argument of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The historical person of Jesus was a remarkable individual, and I can go through tons of proof and evidence. I'm going to stake these arguments on these three points I'm going to make, because most people might think that the resurrection of Jesus is something you just believe in by faith or not. But there are actually three established facts that are recognized by the majority of the New Testament historians today. It's amazing. It's actually recognized by the majority of them. And I believe these are best explained by the resurrection of Jesus. Fact one, we know that his tomb was discovered empty by a group of his women followers. Jakob Kramer, he's an Austrian specialist, he says by far most scholars hold firmly to the reliability of the biblical statements about the empty tomb. And then fact two, on different occasions, different individuals, even enemies of Jesus Christ, experienced appearances of Jesus alive after his death. Garth Ludemann, you guys have heard of him if you're into atheist-theist debates, he said it may be taken as historically certain that the disciples did have experiences after Jesus' death in which Jesus appeared to them as the risen Christ. And Garth Ludemann is an atheist, and even he admits it. Now, fact three, the original disciples suddenly came to believe in the resurrection of Jesus despite having every predisposition to the contrary. You see, guys, Jews had no belief in a dying or rising Messiah. So where did this non-Jewish belief come from? Because the original disciples came to believe so strongly that God had raised Jesus from the dead that they were willing to die for the truth of that belief. N.T. Wright says that is why, as a historian, I cannot explain the rise of early Christianity unless Jesus rose again, leaving an empty tomb behind him. Now, so that was the argument for God's existence, for the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And now we talked about fine-tuning. Let's see what else. I want to give you guys something different because I know you guys are always coming in here. Let's talk about an argument called the argument from contingency. And it goes like this. Everything that exists, let me see how much time I have. Everything that exists has an explanation of its existence, either in the necessity of its own nature or in an external cause. If the universe has an explanation of its existence, that explanation is God. And number three, the universe exists. This is called the argument from contingency. Now, what follows logically from these premises, stick with me. From one and three, it logically follows that four, the universe has an explanation of its existence. And from two and four, the conclusion logically follows five, therefore the explanation of the universe's existence is God. Let's go to the ontological argument. It is possible that a maximally great being exists. And a matter of fact, Phil agrees that it is possible. You could ask him, but he'll be honest. He does agree that it is possible that the Christian God exists, unless he wants to get on and give me an argument against it. And atheists admit this. Even Richard Dawkins admits it. If it is possible that a maximally great being exists, then a maximally great being exists in some possible world. Premise three, if a maximally great being exists in some possible world, then it exists in every possible world. If a maximally great being exists in every possible world, then it exists in the actual world. Premise five, therefore a maximally great being exists in the actual world. Six, therefore a maximally great being exists. And then seven, therefore God exists. Let's go to some other things I wanted to tell you guys. Prophecy. If you go to my website, you guys know where to find it, and you look up prophecy, there's all types of prophecies that have came true in Scripture. I'll give you a couple of. Look up Isaiah 53, which refers to Jesus Christ, obviously, and which was written before Jesus Christ was in the flesh here walking around. And then look at the prophecy of Israel being gathered again to herself as a nation. No other nation in world history has this happened to, and in 1948 it happened, and prophecy was fulfilled. Another argument against atheism is evolution. All we see in evolution is microevolution. Macroevolution has not been proven. And it's been a long time, and Darwin was unsure about these transitional fossils. We should have literally millions upon millions upon millions of transitional fossils. We don't have them. All we see is microevolution. That's another argument against atheism. Well, all we see is really what Scripture says, that God has created them after their own kind. What about ghost demonic activity? I'm sure some of you guys have experienced ghosts, or you know someone that has, or demonic activity. We had a husband and wife come in here, and they were a paranormal investigation team. And the woman, the wife, was telling me she does believe some of them are literally evil. And so this goes against what's called atheist naturalism, where all we see is a natural world. What about, this is something I just want to throw in here. What about atheism's high suicide rate? Atheists have some of the highest suicide rates in the world, and we really do have a heart for atheists. We should create a bumper sticker, friends don't let friends stay atheist. One of the biggest problems against atheism, the biggest argument, is atheism itself. Atheism has no objective purpose in life at all. Even Richard Dawkins admits that atheists have no objective purpose in life. In fact, I don't even know why atheists come in here and debate us if there's no objective purpose. The fact that atheists come in here and debate me shows that they don't really believe what they're talking about. Near-death experiences is empirical damage against atheist naturalism. If you go to my website, go to the music podcast area, you can hear some studies on near-death experiences called NDEs. These are documented proof and evidence of near-death experiences. There's something beyond the natural world, guys. I think we have to admit that. What about, excuse me, what about mind and body? There's a difference between our mind and our body and our mind and our brain. Do you guys remember Christopher Reeve's Superman? Remember when he had the accident on the horse and he couldn't walk? And he would even talk about this. He said that his mind wanted to get up and walk, but his body couldn't do it. For example, when you are happy, your brain isn't happy. You are happy. When you are sad, your brain is not sad. You are sad. There's clearly a difference between the mind and the brain. Every single one of you chose, thanks, Lion, I got it here. Thanks, Lion of God. I got my stopwatch here too, man, but I appreciate it. He's giving me the three-minute warning. I got 3 minutes left. Every single one of you chose to come in here. You have free will. You're not just an atheist flesh machine like a zombie and you come in here because you can't control yourself. You chose to come in here. This shows you guys are awesome. You have a mind. You're not just an atheist flesh machine. Another big problem with atheism is it contradicts itself. What we hear coming out of atheism is that it's possible for God to exist, but we also hear coming out of the atheist camp that it's impossible for God to exist, therefore making atheism null and void. It cannot be true, since what we hear coming out of atheism is it's impossible for God to exist, and it's also impossible. It contradicts itself, therefore it falls down like a house of cards in a hurricane. And argument number 17 is the archaeological proof of the Bible. And my friend Film, he probably can talk to us about that because he's closer to that than we are over here. I'm in the States. Do you know all discoveries through archaeological proof have shown that the Bible is true? And a matter of fact, Film was talking about, I'm sorry, Film, it might not have been you or someone else. I don't want to say something if it's not accurate, but I think it was Film. We were talking about how the Bible has historical accurate information in it where you could actually verify that these things are true. Now, I got about 1 minute left, right? Now, let's see what I went through. I went through the cosmological argument, teleological argument, the moral argument, Jesus Christ, and also we experience God in our life. Unless I can be given a defeater that would show that all my experience is false, I am rational in believing that God exists. We went to the ontological argument. We went through the argument from contingency. I got 30 seconds. We talked about prophecy. We talked about evolution, the lack of the transitional fossils actually going against atheism. We talked about ghost demonic activity. I didn't talk about the evils of atheism, but over 150 million brutal murders, rapes, and genocide under the atheist regimes of Stalin, Pol Pot, Mao, Kim Jong-il, the Khmer Rouge. I went through 17 arguments. Listen, if Film wants us to believe that atheism is true, he must first tear down all 17 of these arguments. Unless and until he does that, and he also gives us an argument why we should believe God doesn't exist, I think that Christian theism is the more rational position. All right, I am done. And Film, thanks, man, for going through that. Hey, Penguin, sorry, guys, I wasn't looking at the screen. Go ahead, Film.
Well, to talk about the opposite thing, that there is no such thing as God, and God does, and my idea that God does not exist. Personally, I haven't really gone through other people's ideas and how Christopher Hitchens, for example, might have his reasons for not believing in a God, but these are my own. Okay? And the first major problem that you have with believing in a God is that all the evidence from God comes from religion. I don't have a problem with religion. If a person uses their religion to do some good in this world, by all means, go on ahead. On the other hand, if you want to give religion credit for doing good, religion must embrace the other side of the coin and take responsibility for the evil that's perpetuated in religion's name. Because, I mean, at the end of the day, religion is just a tool, and it was first assembled when humanity started asking each other about where we came from and where we go when we die, and if there is anywhere to go at all. And the best stories of these kind were handed down orally from generation to generation, include moral lessons on life and rewards and punishment for life here on earth and afterlife beyond. These moral fables and myths, combined with the superstitious nature of human beings, gave people a reason to believe at these stories. And as it became a part of tradition, it was taught to children when they were very young, you know, people grew up mistaking it for the truth. I mean, Sir Shock is now advocating Christian theism, but then he has to also recognize that there's all kinds of theism. So if you're going to recognize the possibility of a God, or make sure it's one God, but it's going to be the same God that's been affecting all these religions around the world. And to go back to my little paper, it was like, who wouldn't believe that there's a great being in the sky responsible for us? I mean, that's when it started becoming taken as fact, when children were raised and taught these stories and they grew up and they believed in it and so on and so forth. But as these stories became more popular, well, they would always be centered around control of these stories, or these religions at the beginning were centered around the elites, you know, how the priests and the kings were the ones running things, and they're the ones who were generally in control of the, let's say, of the nature of the stories and how they were taught to people and who they were taught to, and they were usually manipulated. I mean, yeah, there's moral rules that were always handed down for the specific preservation of a certain specific community, were twisted to better suit the needs of powerful men. And you could see that this day when people look at the Christian Bible and how it's talking about the Israelites from over 2,000 years ago, and they use that to justify things that should be occurring in the United States right now. You could use the same thing when you look at Sharia law, and I've talked to a lot of people who know Sharia law, and it's all based really about advice in a small Bedouin community rather than ruling entire nations. And we've seen how both sides have, how this sort of argument for, I'm sorry, how people abusing religion has led to so much terrible things. I mean, whether it's the Vatican signing off on the enslavement of South America and the Western Hemisphere, and you know, the colonialism and the genocide that happened when the Western European nations started to finally explore and conquer the New World. You know, when the Vatican. Excuse me, guys. Let me get this back on track. Yeah. Anyways, to suit powerful men and powerful organizations, these vague notions always gave them credibility for specific actions, whether good or bad, but always used to increase power of the respective population. Whether the Vatican signed off on the enslavement of South America in order to gain wealth, power, influence, or the same church upholding the humanitarian work of Mother Teresa for all the world to see, the message is clear. Revere us, respect us, believe in us, support us, financially support us if you have to, because we have God on our side. And they can only promise you that, either promise you paradise or condemn you to burn to hell forever, but you have to believe what this person says, what this man, this human being says. All their evidence is vague and ancient, and not really directly related to what you really might not need, but you have to take that leap of faith and believe without any evidence. So when we talk about if we talk about believing in God or believing that a God exists and all the evidence is around religion, I mean, religion is a tool, and it can be manipulated any way, shape, or form. So for me, this is the first sign that this is where you first should start take things with a grain of salt, okay? And then after I looked at how religion was, I thought, well, okay, if there really was a God and there is one God, then there would have to be certain characteristics that God would have to fulfill as an all-powerful deity. The first thing is, God, no offense to anyone, but I hope you don't take this the wrong way, but God is an alien. I don't mean like an alien like in the X-Files or a science fiction movie. What I mean is, God does not come from Earth or the universe, because he created both. He created this, but he he's not from the earth or universe, but he made us in his image. If God was real, he could not have had our physiology because he would have existed outside the realm of physical laws. And if he had made us in his image, human beings would only be would only have one image to reflect back on him. I think the differing natures of human bodies and races and even life in general, the way it's just so varied across the globe, is really a huge testament of evolution. And God didn't decide to make one thing and just disappear after that. Another one of the old myths was that God would always live above us. And you know, this is fake. I mean, technologically speaking, you can go, we have human beings have been to space. You can use telescopes and see incredibly far into the distance. I mean, checking out my facts to be sure, but like you have the Hubble telescope, who's the new replacement for the Hubble telescope. They could see 14 billion light years into the distance, which really means to the past. And they could see that, no, there's no heaven floating around out there. There's no deity chilling. And it actually shows how large the universe is. So when Shock was talking about how things had happened by luck, yeah, the odds are actually on our side on that, because the universe is just huge. Another problem I found with the existence of a God is that you have to accept that he was not created, okay? I mean, Shock was just asking us to believe that the universe could not come from nothing, but at the same time, we have to accept that God came from nothing and was just always there and was always eternal. So I guess the logic will follow, well, if the universe cannot be eternal, why in the world should God himself be eternal? No. Another reason I found for disbelief in God is that the myth that God needs you, the omnipresent, the omnipotent, the all-powerful, mighty being needs you, that we are his chosen people. But I think the truth is there are no specifically chosen people. Everybody that shares a deep belief in God believes that they're special because of your individual emotional attachment to your beliefs. Though this attachment is special to you, the attachment is not more special than anybody else's. Yet the need to feel separate and the need to feel superior to the next guy allows people to believe that they are destined for great things, when the truth is that even if you are, you're certainly not so special that the creator of the universe needs you to do things for him. Now, if you're going to ascribe God all this magnificent, powerful, epic, you know, levels of power, he doesn't need the everyday person to go and pray and wish God a good day, and he just wouldn't need that. I guess it would be sort of the nature of people discovering that ants worshipped people that they couldn't even fathom. You'd be like, why in the world would an ant need to worship us? They could go around and live their lives as they want to. I mean, something like that. And another thing about how unique people want to feel is that, I mean, the reason why I started thinking that people who believe are not necessarily special is because, I mean, as I traveled around the world, I've seen that every religion have followers who believe in their religion with just as much conviction as Shock has in Jesus, as some of my friends here have faith in Islam, how my other friends have just as much faith in their Zen Buddhism, and some of them have big faith in Rastafarianism, but they believe in it really, really hard. And that made me come to the conclusion that, okay, everybody's believing the same thing. Everybody's believing that something exists, but none of them could agree that only one of them... Ah, sorry. Yeah, bad point on debate there. Anyways, so yeah, you have lots of different people who believe that they specifically are right and that nobody else is, but they'll never look at the possibility that they themselves could be wrong. Okay. And also I have the another point is that people talk about God and they talk about evil and they say, well, if the devil came from God, then God must have created evil. And then other people say, no, evil is just the absence of God. And I think it's a huge contradiction, which leads me to believe that the nature of God is false, because either God created evil, and we as human beings know the great evil that people can do, and this doesn't sound like a very benevolent, loving creator, or he didn't create evil, and evil is the absence of God, making sure that God is not omnipresent. That means he has to be in just one place at one time. And if he is only one place at one time, then it also goes back to he can't be everywhere at once, then he's not this mighty being that exists across dimensions and places. He's just it's just a story. It's just a fictional story. Okay, I'm not sure how much time I have left, but in closing, I would like to say this. I think that the final proof that God does not exist is you and me and human beings. We are not the tools of a supernatural puppet master. We are free, living, rational, thinking human beings. We are the collection of atoms that ask why we exist. We are the living organisms whose daily lives are consumed by the natural chaos and random occurrence that has shaped our biological history and the history of life as we know it. We are the complete opposite of whatever God there may be. We are not immortal. We are of this earth. We are not omnipresent or psychic. In fact, we're the exact opposite of deity because we're not formed from a deity. We are flesh and blood, a product of life, natural rules, and biological, of natural rules, biological, and social. Our lives have as much purpose as we put into it, and there has yet to be a man, woman, or child, even if they cite God as an inspiration for what they do, who have not done had to do all the hard work themselves. Because God doesn't make any physical appearances. He does not punish. We punish those who hurt us, if we can. He does not save sinners. We save each other. That love that you feel in your church, mosque, or temple, that's not the love of God, but the brotherhood of humanity you're feeling. Whether you like it or not, atheists and non-believers feel it too. God does not forgive you for what you have done. You hear us, your fellow people, forgive you when you hurt us, because we are really here and we're really the ones who care. And he is neither here nor cares, because he is not real, but we are. Never forget religion is a tool, and while practicing your faith, don't be afraid to ask the tough questions. You might find the gem of an answer. Take care. And I wrote down some of Shock's points, which I'd like to answer, which I'd like to bring up when we have the 5 minute or 10 minute rebuttals of each other's argument. But I guess this is my opening statement. It's been a little shaky. I haven't really had time to practice it, but thanks for listening, guys. Peace.
All right, man. Hey, what was it, 10 minutes now that we get film? Let me make sure. Let me check with the strict. Okay, 10 minutes. Okay, let me start. Hold on. Okay, I just started. Go. Well, I wrote down the arguments that you gave, and it kind of seemed like more arguments against religion, per se. And I think some of those... maybe you and I would agree on, like, Sharia law and stuff like that. But let's go through what he said. First of all, you said the reasons that God doesn't exist, you said evidence comes from religion. So I think everyone in the room was on the edge of our chair waiting for your argument, but then you didn't say anything. So it's not logical to say that God doesn't exist because evidence comes from religion. You have to give an argument for that. For example, let's say that you and I lived hundreds and hundreds, you know, let's say we lived back when scientists thought the Earth was flat. Did you guys know that? That at one point the scientists of that age thought the Earth was flat, or it sat on the back of turtles, or Atlas was holding it up. Well, but let's say that film, you and I believe the Earth was more round, you know, more spherical. Just because, let's say we were of a religion, for example, the Bible says that God sits on the circle of the Earth. So let's say that we believed what the Bible said, that the Earth is not flat. You can't say, well, because a religion taught us that, therefore it's not true. What you're committing is it's almost like a genetic type of fallacy. You can't say something is wrong based on where it comes from. So that's almost like a genetic fallacy. For example, if I'm a Christian and, you know, I believe a certain thing and that certain thing is true, you can't say that it's wrong just because I'm a Christian. So that argument falls to the ground. You can't really use that argument because of religion. But nevertheless, I use science, I use philosophy, I use common sense. I didn't use religion even in my arguments. But even if I did, you'd have to give an argument why it wouldn't be true. Okay, I got 10 minutes. I better quit blabbing. Now, I want you guys to notice he talked about evil being perpetuated in the name of religion, for example, like Sharia law. Well, I agree with that, but then that means that the moral argument goes on my side of the debate, because he just admitted that some things are evil, and if there are some things that are evil, then that means that there's some things that are good. So he just gave me on a silver platter objective morality. So I want to thank you for that, film. So objective morality goes on my side of the debate. Now, you said if there was a God, there should be certain characteristics he should have. And you talked about how some people will say, like heaven, you know, looking up and things like that. But that's, you know, that's just like a phrase that people will use. It's sort of like when someone says the sun is setting, you know, or the sun is coming up. If you look at what Scripture said, do you guys remember when they asked Jesus about the kingdom of God, where is it? And he said the kingdom of God in that translation is among you. He's basically saying he's God. So he didn't say, oh, it's up here in this guy. He was basically claiming to be God. So I didn't really hear any arguments against God. I heard you talk about the Catholic Church, Sharia law and stuff like that. So I'm trying to find something that should be about the debate. Oh, let's talk about, here's one thing you did talk about God. You said, well, why is God eternal but the universe isn't? Why can't, you stop short of saying, why can't the universe be eternal? The problem is we know the universe isn't eternal. Now, I can't stop you in debate from saying the universe is eternal. I really hope you don't do that, because you're going against what science is saying. The Bohr-Guth-Vilenkin theorem clearly states that any universe that is in the process of on average expanding, which ours is, must have had a beginning, even if you want to posit multiverse, steady state, oscillating universe, whatever. So the problem is what atheists want to say is that God is not eternal and the universe is. But just like anything, the atheist is like Wile E. Coyote, you know, they try to succeed, but they put on the metal roller skates, the rocket on their back, and they fly off the cliff to their doom, because in reality, God is eternal and the universe isn't. I'm sorry, that's just the facts. And then if you were saying, well, why, you were talking about why couldn't God be created or something, well, then he wouldn't be God. So you kind of destroy your own argument even by the way you set it up, because God is not created. So I think what people want, what atheists want, is they want so bad the universe to be eternal. And I will say there was one point in history where a lot of scientists believed that, and Christians were ridiculed for saying, no, the universe had a beginning. And now in modern times, 2012, Christians have been vindicated, and now science has come around to reality, which is what Scripture always said, that God created the universe, and that the universe had a beginning, and the scientists agree with that. Check out, if you go to shotgunnow.net, check out the Bohr-Guth-Vilenkin theorem, which clearly states any universe that is in the process of expanding, like ours is, must have had a beginning. So I just don't think, film, that you're going to be able to use that escape in this debate, man. Now, here's something else that doesn't really follow logically, and I'm watching my clock here. You said, well, because people follow different religions and everyone's saying, all these people are saying they believe in God and stuff, that wouldn't lead me to believe that God doesn't exist. That would lead me to believe, hey, there's something to this. So it doesn't follow logically that all these people are reaching out to God, and I will say that they're reaching out to God in different ways. I'm going to tell you what Dinesh D'Souza said. Hey, film, have you ever heard of Dinesh D'Souza? I think you'd like him, man. He's a really good speaker. And here's what he said. He kind of said what you said. He said, what religion does is it recognizes that mankind is fallen short. And film, I think you and I would agree that the world is not operating the way you and I would like it to. I think you and I agree on that, you know, with the wars and all this other stuff. He says, and what Dinesh D'Souza said, he said, and what religion does is it recognizes this, and it tries to create a higher plane. This is why when you were saying how people think that their heaven is upward, and religion tries to create this higher plane to reach a higher state. perfect love, perfect goodness, perfect joy, you know, like that. That's what religion tries through, dietary laws, different things like that, but it falls short. What atheism does is it's like the guy that has a check engine light on his car and he gets some electric tape and just he's tired of seeing the light. It ignores the problem and says, forget about it, you know, just the way it is. But what Jesus Christ did is he fills that gap. He allows us to go ahead and come into fellowship with God. And so I think I would agree with you. I don't think religion per se is the answer. And you and I talked about this a little last time when you were here. If you read scripture, who were the people that Jesus had problems with? It was the ultra dogmatic religious folks. He didn't have problems with people like you and I, Phil. I think you and Jesus would have agreed on some of those things, you know, and as far as religion. But let's not be hypocrites. Look at the 150 million plus murders and brutal rapes and genocide under the atheist regimes of Stalin, Mao, Pol Pot, Kim Jong-il, Khmer Rouge. You and I agree that what they did was evil also, but that's why the objective moral argument goes onto my side. Let's see what else. You said that we're not tools of a puppet master. Well, let me tell you what Jesus Christ said. Jesus Christ said, those that have sinned are slaves to their sin. So when I was an atheist, I was literally a slave to my sin. So thank God for Jesus Christ, who has set me free from the slavery of atheism. I say, Film, that you join me, brother. I think you should become a Christian. You take off the ball and chains of slavery and you set yourself free in Jesus Christ. Well, I got 30 seconds. He didn't really address the teleological argument, the cosmological argument still stands. The immoral argument goes on my side. He didn't really talk about Jesus Christ. Experiential reality, ontological argument, evolution. He didn't really talk about prophecy, ghost, demonic activity, the evils of atheism. He really hasn't talked about any of my arguments, but he said he's going to do so right now, so I'll listen to those arguments. And thanks for listening.
All right, so, I was busy taking notes while you were speaking as well. So let me go over the arguments as quickly as I could write them down. And understand you came up with 17 different points, and I'm not sure if I have 17 different answers ready for you, but here's the ones that I have. When you first say that, I know you're talking about the universe not being eternal, and for me, that's like a big, of course the universe is not eternal. It all had to come start at some place, and every scientist, it's already predicted by scientists, but still. So I'm saying I'm not going down the path of saying the universe is immortal, but you still have to answer why God should be immortal. I mean, we're talking about a being that's outside of the known universe. And you said, and God has talked about how there's, even in the Bible, he said how there's others. And if there's others, that means there's other things more than him. And you said if God was created, then he wouldn't be God anymore. And I would have to ask the question, is why? Why shouldn't there be God anymore? Well, because, I mean, if you think that God being created ends the whole purpose of God being real, then, hey man, welcome to atheism. and moral laws. Now this one, I was really interested when you brought it up because I do read a lot into to human rights and natural rights, and I just want to say that moral laws, I mean, as recognized by the world and the UN, are the natural laws about human beings in our natural state. The fact that speaking for human beings is natural, thinking is natural, travel is natural. Property over your own body and over land is natural. I mean, that's why you have your rights and you have your Bill of Rights in the United States and you have the Human Rights Charter in the UN. If you read it, it doesn't talk about talks about morality coming from the need for human beings to able to coexist with each other, and this has been going on independent of God, because you have moral systems everywhere in place, regardless or not whether or not it's a Christian morality. So I'm not sure how well that answer that for you. Okay. Another thing that you said is that if it's possible that God exists, then God must exist in every possible world. And I was wondering how you make that huge jump from existing in every that just because it's possible God can exist, that he must exist everywhere. I mean because it's impossible to oh man, I didn't write all that. Yeah, and if he exists in every possible world and he's omnipresent and everything, he's a super all-powerful being. Goes back to one of the points I tried to make, that him being too powerful to even care about us, because I can't imagine living in every single possible dimension and going back to these creatures that I supposedly created on the planet millions and millions of years ago. Here's a point that you brought up, Shock, about evolution. You said evolution is proof that atheism is false. So this is going to be a side question. I was wondering if you were talking about, if you were advocating evolution as proof of atheism's falsehood, and doesn't that somehow demonstrate that you believe that evolution is, or Darwinism is more true than creationism? You talked about how my argument was mostly centered on religion. And I'm sorry if I didn't make that clear, but my idea was that the stories of God come from religion. Now, you're not automatically wrong because you have a religious belief, but if your religious belief is accepted to be wrong, kind of like how you're talking about Sharia and the Muslims, like, well, you expect their religious beliefs to be wrong, not for a moral sake, but because they believe in a different God than yours. That makes it equally possible for those Muslims to believe that their same one omnipresent God would think that your religion is false and the God of the Christians is just a made up thing. And if we have this all powerful omnipresent deity that's everywhere at once, everyone should have the same idea of everyone should have the same revelation. Everybody should have the same kind of religion, because it's every religion goes. Talks about the creation myth and how God came and created people, but that's as far as similarities go. Some people say he became he handed down power to the Emperor of Japan, and Emperor of Japan was worshipped as a deity until the 1940s, you know. And the Muslims believe he showed up and told Muhammad all these stories in the desert, and the Christians believe that Jesus Christ was born. Of God. I don't even know why the creative universe, who evidently made man out of dust and a woman out of a bone, would have to impregnate a woman to create life, you know? All this being said, I'm not saying that historically, like, religion is also complex. I'm not saying that events that occurred historically that are recorded in a religious text are false. As Shaq mentioned earlier, yes, I am in Amman, in Jordan, and this is where a lot of biblical, you know, it's in the Holy Land. A lot of biblical things have happened back here. But that doesn't mean, just because the actions that were taken by men in those biblical times ended up to be true, does not necessarily mean that a God did it for them, you know, that God is real. It just shows that people who had a religious belief 2,000 or more years ago were they had faith and they had their own civilization and they believed in the God and they left their record of their civilization here. Doesn't mean that they were right any more than the Greeks were right when they have the Parthenon in Athens and saying there must be Zeus and Hermes and Venus up in the sky as well. You were talking about evolution. Some more, I mean, you said there's no macrological proof that evolution exists, and you're going to talk, I was going to point out that, yes, one of my favorite examples, because I do love eating chicken, is that chicken, birds, specifically, are known to evolve from dinosaurs, they have the evidence of that from the fossil record, starting from more than 65 million years ago, because they found out, like, Velociraptor, for example, as everybody knows from the movies, had feathers. And this was well before dinosaurs went extinct, and Archaeopteryx, I remember somebody on this board was pointing out earlier, and it's evolved into now. I mean, the proof of that is just outstanding. It's almost impossible to question. But yeah, I hope that proves that evolution, that's one example that evolution is real. Jesus, what a person. Okay. Yes, so, oh, and about ghosts. Yeah, ghosts and demonic possession. I'm telling you that is absolutely false. And the main reason I give for this falsehood is because ghosts are supposed to come around when people die in very terrible ways. And I'm thinking if that's true, there should be over 100 million African slaves taken over the U.S. right now in their spirits. There would be the same 150 million people that were killed under Stalinism and fascism running amok all over the world. There's so many people have died in so many terrible ways, but we're only expected to believe that only a certain few could come out and do it. I mean, well, that's a tough nut for me to swallow, man. I think it's just as I think that's very, very ridiculous and kind of offensive when you think about it. That only certain people get to come back and other people don't, based on what? Can't be their faith. And okay, I think I'm running out of time. And the closest ancestor for Archaeopteryx, like I said, it's Velociraptor. Look up the theropods. In your paleontology class, theropods, they evolved into chickens. There's too many parts to go on. I wish we could talk about this more, but I see I'm out of time. And I hope I can answer some of your questions soon. Thanks for listening. Bye.
All right, let me get the clock. I'm still laughing about the chicken comment. Colonel Sanders right now is like, oh, I could have been a million, billion, quadrillionaire with those chicken dinosaurs. That's the funniest thing I've ever heard in debate. Okay, I start the clock. Guys, as you can see, we haven't heard any arguments of why we should believe God doesn't exist. On the cosmological argument, he agrees the universe has a beginning. On the fine-tuning, he didn't address that. On the moral argument, I'm going to talk about that. He actually gave that to me in a silver platter. He admitted that evil exists, and if evil exists, then that means good exists, and so objective values exist. On Jesus Christ, he didn't talk at all about that. Experiential reality, he didn't talk about how Christians experience God in their life. Ontological argument, he just talked about that, like he said he don't understand it, but he didn't give me an argument for that. On the argument from contingency, he didn't talk about that. Prophecy, he didn't address that. On evolution, he didn't give us any proof of these transitional fossils, except he talked about how chickens came from dinosaurs, and he hasn't proven that. Ghost demonic activity, he said, well, he believes it's false because ghosts are supposed to come around when every person dies. That's not really what anyone said. So the ghost demonic activity, the evils of atheism, he didn't address that. Atheist high suicide rate, he didn't say that. Atheists having no objective purpose in life, he didn't really address that. I think he agrees with that. Near-death experiences, he didn't address that. The mind and body dualism, you know, how we have a brain and a mind, he didn't address that. All my arguments still stand. He didn't address the contradiction, how out of the atheist camp we hear atheists saying it's impossible for God to exist. And I know you believe it's possible. Film actually believes it's possible for God to exist. So given the ontological argument, that still stands. And then on the archaeological proof of the accuracy of the Bible, how all the archaeological proof has shown the Bible is accurate, he didn't address that. Now let me go through some things. I'm tempted just to kick back and just say, hey, you know what, this was a great debate, because obviously atheism has lost this debate. But let me go through some of the things, because Film and I, you know, we become good friends from across the water in the desert. Okay, Film, can I ask you, well, I don't want to break the rules. I don't want to ask you a question, but I wanted to kind of you to think about this in your mind. Do you know the difference between moral ontology and moral epistemology? There's moral ontology, like the ontological argument, which is the existence of objective moral values. And then there's moral epistemology. I think you're confusing epistemology with ontology. Epistemology is like how you and I come to learn about objective moral values. Ontological, the ontology, moral ontology, is the existence of it. So I think you're confused on that. What I would do is I would suggest look up ontology and epistemology. They're two different things. On evolution, I think anyone that just go to creation.com and look up where are the millions and millions of transitional fossils. And let me just give you an example. Film, you and I have heard that some evolutionists, like Dawkins, they believe a bat and a whale share common ancestry. Now think about that, Film. A bat and a whale are both mammals and vertebrates, right? Think of all the millions of transitional fossils, all the different forms that we would have for a bat and a whale to share this common ancestry. And guess what, guys? These fossils, these transitional fossils, they are not there. Macroevolution has not been proven. All we see is change within limits. So that's really the only thing atheists could use is try to posit macroevolution, but they don't even have that. And we now know with modern science the universe has a beginning. So this is why I got to tell you guys, do you know atheism is now declining worldwide as a whole? They're losing 800 people per day. Atheism's losing 800 people per day. Well, I got 30 seconds. Guys, here's the thing. You've heard the debate. We haven't heard any reasons why we should believe God doesn't exist. We heard him talk about Sharia law and the Catholic Church and stuff, but we haven't heard any reasons to believe why God doesn't exist. And unless I'm provided with the defeater and the Christians are rationally justified to believe that God exists, since we haven't had any reasons to believe God doesn't. So thanks for listening, guys. I think it's obviously clear that we can rest assured that God exists and that atheism is just not true.
All right, if it's on, yeah, okay, so I have 5 minutes from now. Well, I mean, just to give that part back to you, when you said that, how can we believe that chickens or birds evolved from dinosaurs? Well, there's found a couple papers from Berkeley University, PBS, The Life of Birds, Evolution, skull analysis that charts the change from dinosaurs into birds. I think that's just one example, and you can check, that's one thing that's studied in the constant fossil record. And if you even go back farther, I mean, you can find transitional fossils from one species to another, like not necessarily species that are alive now, mind you. But yeah, if you're trying to compare a bat to a whale and say, how did a whale change from a bat? Well, no, they obviously went down different evolutionary paths, but yeah, they did have a common ancestor. I mean, if you go back far enough in time, everything has a common ancestor. I mean, it all goes back to everything coming back to singularity and point, and I think that's something you could use for saying evidence of God. And but it's just as easy to say, it's like, nah, well, yeah. But I see that you haven't, because it's really tough to acknowledge evolution over creationism if you're just taking the Christian-specific God. Yeah, you said I didn't address suicide, and I thought that was right, because nobody I know has committed suicide. I haven't heard of any suicide, rampant suicide rates across the realm of atheism. I kind of don't, that part of the world doesn't, I want to say it's not disturbing to think of that, have the idea that, you know, that people might kill themselves because they can't find a God or a conviction that they don't believe in God. But at the same time, where is your real evidence for that? I mean, were you pulling out statistics from where? From You didn't bring any statistics up. It's kind of like earlier when you kind of made like a side dig at atheism, and you were like, "Oh, did you know that atheisms believe in bestiality too?" I'm like, "Come on, man. Come on. Where's the evidence for that?" What else was there? Oh, if you wanted me to talk about Jesus, then I'm telling you, I do think that Jesus was a real person. That Jesus did exist, but I don't believe in the mythological things that were ascribed to him by later generations when they finally wrote it down and they went to the Council of Nicaea to decide what story of Jesus should we tell. So these inconsistencies, that's why I don't really believe in the mythological side of Jesus. But I do know that he was a real person. I think lots of people follow him because of his philosophical views, rather than the fact that he was, rather than the belief that people had of him, that he must have come from God in virgin birth. When I brought the Catholic Church and I brought up Islam, I think that was me demonstrating that religion is our record of humanity's interaction with God. Whether it's a religious organization or religion that people like you might have, just reading your Bible and deciding for yourself what you want to believe from it, what you don't want to believe from it. Religion is still a recording, it's a recorded history of human beings' interaction with God. And if it's so ambiguous, if it's so, what's the word I'm looking for? If it's not uniform for an omnipresent God, then that for me, that's the most clear, one of the biggest points, that there is no omnipresent God. It doesn't have an omnipresent force. Otherwise, everyone would have the same religion, but nobody does, and everybody bothers with convincing other people of their own beliefs. And I think people should just leave well enough alone. If you wanted to, all right, Shagunar. Okay. Yeah, I could see it. Maybe you could see anything in 5 seconds on the internet. It's the internet, don't forget. Dolphins and dogs are generally close. Well, it'd be the case. No, I'm not a creationist. I think evolution is key. Oh, man, I should have looked at the chat board because it just threw me way off. And if you wanted to go on to the morality side of it, I think that's clearly entered in the United Nations Charter of Human Rights on what morality means for human beings, and you'll find that there's no mention of a god or a religion anywhere, except for people being free as human beings, owning your own body, free to think and free to believe what you want to believe. I should have touched on free will earlier. All right. Okay, Shock wants to ask a question, but before I go, I should have touched on. Okay, man, I lost track of what I was gonna say. But okay, Shock, go ahead.
All right, it's an easy question, man. But I just want to say something on the UN thing. What you're talking about, you're confusing moral ontology with moral epistemology. You need to look up the difference between that. The fact that the United Nations recognize these values are objective values, this is moral epistemology. In other words, if the United Nations didn't exist, the objective values would still exist. But because the United Nations recognizes them and comes to learn them and puts them in a charter, that doesn't go towards your side of the argument. That is actually showing that objective values exist. So you're kind of like setting up a trap and you're stepping in it. What you're basically saying is even the United Nations recognizes objective values. So I think you might want to stop while you're behind. Okay, here's the question I have for you, okay? You said that we have the transitional fossils. Without evading, I'm going to get off the mic. Without evading, give me an approximate number of how many transitional fossils we have discovered. Go ahead.
approximate number? Man, I couldn't give you an approximate number, but I could definitely tell you it's got to be somewhere in the, at least in the hundreds, if not the thousands. I mean, you go to any natural history museum in the world, and they all have different examples of what came from what. Like just the bird reference I was giving to you earlier. I mean, you just have to look at any dinosaur fossil from the late Cretaceous period. They all have bird characteristics. And it goes on from there throughout the Ice Age, you know, past the extinction event and goes on to the Ice Age. I mean, you can go to any natural history museum and find it. I can't say for sure because I'm not an expert in paleontology on how many fossils they have. But I'm telling you, it's not, the number is not the zero that you're claiming. Because for you, Ashok, for there to be no evolution, there has to be no fossils. There has to be no similarities. But if that was true, then why isn't everything that ever existed alive today? I mean, you go to science, they'll tell you 99% of all life on Earth is extinct right now due to the forces of evolution. So if you, I'm not sure if you're a creationist, because you didn't really talk about life. You just talked more or less about the morality and some arguments on why there should be a God, but not really on why the existence of life reflects on the existence of God. I think I tried to touch that earlier when I said God is not of this universe. If he was real, if he's not of this universe, we could not be made in his image, because then we would look like things that were not made in this universe. God isn't. And to answer another question you put up about moral laws, yes, and you're saying, okay, even if the United Nations didn't exist, then these moral values would still be there. And then I'd have to turn around asking, why aren't all moral values the same and constant? They're not. The morality in the Old Testament is very different from the morality in the New Testament. But God existed in both places. The morality in Christianity is different from the morality in Hinduism. These are not moral constants. I mean, you just have the very same basic ones that every human being goes through to stay alive. I mean, do not kill. Do not forcefully imprison things. But these are people. These moral stances are coming from people that don't want to have these things done unto them. And they had to give a good reason why. I mean, you go to somebody who, not even a good reason, they need a justification to have people do what they do, and that's where the God argument comes in. But you have other religions or other beliefs, like Buddhism, for example, which doesn't have a God, has spirituality in it, but doesn't have a God, and they still have their own moral standards. You go anywhere in the world, they still have the same basic moral code, but since it's not all the same, you can't say that one God gave everybody the same message. And that's something you haven't answered at all. It's like, why are all these different, why does everyone have a different religion? Why does everybody have a different faith in God if he came to the world at once? He made everybody at the same time from two people. And instead of keeping that story, instead of telling that story to all the different civilizations that human beings have had, everyone has had their own different story. This shows that God had no part in it, and it was all from the from the imagination of the people who needed God for them to exist.
All right. I want to bring this to your attention. You guys notice he can't say that we have any transitional fossils. I want you guys to notice that. This is the typical error of the atheist agnostic evolutionist. When you press them and you say, how many transitional fossils have we discovered? Where is the missing link? How many transitional fossils have we discovered? You notice he stuttered and stammered and he goes, well, maybe thousands, maybe hundreds. He doesn't know. But he has to perpetuate the lie of macroevolution, because every time someone's saying like macroevolution is true, I go, are you an atheist agnostic? They go, yes. I go, I rest my case. They have to promote the lie to support their lifestyle. Okay, here's the thing. He doesn't know how many transitional fossils are. We don't have these transitional fossils, guys. Now, he's trying to say also that because there's a lot of religions of people reaching out to God, therefore God doesn't exist. Now, let's really unbiasedly look at this. Why would I, as a rational human being, think that all these people reaching out to God in different ways and different religions would then say, well, that I guess God doesn't exist? Any rational person would have the complete opposite. It'd be like this. Let's say Penguin and Paolo and MSL and Mr. James, you guys hear about at Film's house, there's a barbecue, and you guys love barbecue, and I hear about it too. And other people of other religions are talking about this barbecue. You guys wouldn't say, well, then there logically probably isn't a barbecue. What you would say is, all these people saying that there is, and all these people, logically, there must be one. Film, the argument that you're giving, again, you've set a trap and you stepped in it. Your argument is proving the complete opposite of what you want to say. All these people, and matter of fact, I have to tell you, I was doing a radio show, and if I can give you a plug for my, if you go to www.shockawenow.net, and Lion, I know you want to get online. I've got, I'll hurry, man. But if you go there and you go to Block Talk Radio, I had a caller call in, Film. You'll find this interesting. And he brought this up, and he said, he goes, you know, Rich, he goes, they've also seen tribes of people all over the world that never even met each other. Sorry about that. How far did I get? I hit the wrong button. What I was saying is where did I leave off, guys? I hit the button. Oh, yeah, tribes all over. Thanks, James. Yeah. And what's amazing, they've also done studies of this, and you guys know, even in scientific journals, they're saying that mankind is wired, W-I-R-E-D, to reach out to God. You've read that, Film. I know you've read that, man. Yeah, tribes all over. Thanks, Film. So there's obviously something here. The fact that people all over are also reaching, and that's not the argument that I gave, that's what Film said. But Film, your argument actually, I think I'm going to, Film, I'm going to do something. I'm going to use the argument in my next debate, the one that you just gave, because I think that argument is a very powerful argument for God. Now, out of respect to Film, because he's been a really good guy and stuff, Film, and I do call you my friend, man. I hope you come in more often here. But Film, you know, I get asked that a lot. They say, well, why not Islam? Why not this religion? Why not that religion? Well, because I've researched them, and whenever someone says, well, what about the other gods? I'll get that, and I usually get that from atheists. I always say this, listen, guys, what other gods? What other god has shown himself to the world more than the Christian God? What other gods? They'll say, well, what about Zeus? Hey, the Christians destroyed Zeus. That's why we don't have that. Yeah, the Christians destroyed Thor. There is no other God. You guys know this. So what you're talking about is, when you talk about Islam, and if you actually research Islam, hundreds and hundreds of years later, the Quran was written, and I just want to tell you, because out of respect to Film, he, you deserve an answer. I have friends that are Muslims. They're nice folks and stuff. They come in here, we talk to them, we disagree on things. But the problem, though, is, and you guys research this, a lot of folks in Islam, they believe that, guess who was crucified on the cross, Film? Take a guess. Do you guys know who Islam says was? That's right. Judas, they say, was crucified. And Phil, even you and I agree that that's historically inaccurate. I've got atheist friends that pop in here, and they go, yeah, that is really historically inaccurate. So, you know, Muhammad was getting this, like, second hand, third hand, fourth hand, you know, and he just didn't get it right. Now, what about Buddha? You brought up the Buddha. Did you know, and I'm not making this up, the Buddha ate his own excrement underneath the tree? Did you ever read that film? Have you guys read that? Now, film, call me judgmental, but when someone eats their own excrement, I'm not going to listen to what they're saying. I'm sorry. Film, can you imagine the Buddha's your uncle and he goes to hug you like at Christmas time and he's going to kiss you on the cheek? You're like, no thanks. Here's some Listerine. Yeah, so I think you bring up some good things, but let me just get off the mic. But before I go, I want to show you something real quick. I'm not going to do the slideshow because I know Lion wanted to say something. Guys, look, the reason why I like these debates is if you look on my side of the debate, I had 17 arguments. The arguments that you brought up, film, I liked your arguments, but they actually, you admitted that evil exists. So that goes on my side of the debate, the moral argument. The fine-tuning, you didn't talk about that. The cosmological argument, you admit that the universe is not eternal. Jesus Christ, you admit that he existed. Ontological argument, argument from contingency prophecy, you didn't really talk about that. On the transitional fossils, I asked you, well, where are they? And you said, well, maybe we have thousands, maybe we have hundreds. The truth is, film, be honest, you know we don't have one dang transitional fossil. For you to say thousands and then hundreds shows that atheism is full of crapola. On the ghost and demonic activity, it's just your opinion that this just doesn't exist or something. I don't get that. I think if you and I went where you live and we knocked on a few doors over there in Jordan, we'd have people say, yeah, you know what, they do, it does happen. And Phil, what you're posting is microevolution. Those are not transitional fossils. Microevolution is how you have different types of dogs, different types of horses, and it is true that they're different shapes, but they're all dogs, different types of dogs, and the horses, they're all horses. And then on the bat and the whale having common ancestry, we don't have these transitional fossils. Let me give you an example real quick, because Lion of God's been very patient. You remember the evolutionists were saying, oh, the Pachycetus over time, you know, millions and millions of years, and it became a whale. And do you know the evolutionists are now backing off from that? They're now saying that, well, okay, maybe that's not true. Fact of the matter, guys, is listen, for a bat and a whale to share common ancestry, we should have millions upon millions of fossils just right there. We should have millions of transitional forms right there. And think of all the species we have. Even film one said, well, maybe we have hundreds, you know. Where are they? Lack of evidence is not evidence. So anyways, I think anyone that listens to this debate will see that the weight of the argument clearly is on the side of Christian theism. And I have to be honest with you guys, we've asked, who's that other guy? Beetleman left. But Beetleman was in here, I think it was him, and we were saying, we were trying to think of some good arguments for atheists. We were actually trying to think, well, you know, what's a really good argument? And we couldn't think of any. And I think this is why atheism is now declining worldwide, about 800 people per day. So thanks for listening, guys. I think we'd be confident that God exists. Film didn't kill him. Film wasn't able to convert us. Go ahead, Lion of God. And thanks for listening to the debate, guys.